lot of things in life I don't know. And not knowing is the scary part. Like, what's in the deep end? Could be anything. I'll never know until I jump.
I jumped.
Whoa, look at that water. I got it. Drop the mic. How y'all doing today? Man, God's good, isn't he? Yeah, we want to welcome everybody in. Of course, everybody in the room, those down in Vieira, those over in Cocoa, those next door in the Avenue. We're glad to just be involved with the East Coast, wherever you're seated. Doesn't really matter. You're part of the family here at East Coast Christian Center. And more importantly, you're part of the family of God, and that's cool. We love you guys. Appreciate it. We're in a series. We're in a third message in a series called Without a Doubt. Today, I think I'm going to call this Getting the Doubt Out, or Shout It Out, or something like that. I don't know, cheap commercial for some sort of cleansing product that's out there. But before we get into it today, let's pray. Father, we do love you. We do honor you. We do thank you for wonderful worship today. Focus on your name. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And Lord, so many of us have bowed our knees to your name, and we worship you as Lord and Savior. And Lord, but more than that, you gave us your name. And you said that when we prayed things and we asked things according to your will in your name, that you'd do it. And it's an incredible, amazing thing that you've done for us. So Lord, right now we ask in Jesus' name that this doubt thing, discouragement thing that tries to get a hold of our hearts would get further beat back and pushed back, and that we would walk more and more, live by faith, walk by faith, more and more in our lives, and that you'd be honored in that process because we believe in you and we have our hope in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody said, amen. Amen. You know, some people must really not like their faces. And I say that because of some of the things I've seen done to faces. Let's look at the first one here. Wow. I don't know. Handsome young man. Different looking man. It just was a huge change, and I don't know what it was in Michael that drove him to keep working on that, keep working on that. What in him didn't rejoice in who God had made or what it was? I don't know. And then people fight the age thing. Here's one of the famous age fighters of the century, Joan Rivers. That's actually one of the best pictures of her with her 37, I think, facial surgeries or whatever it was. This is what she looked like as a young lady. This is not the only things going on. There's this other thing out there called the Kylie Jenner challenge. I guess Kylie Jenner has pouty lips. I don't really know who she is. So what they're doing, kids are doing out there. This is a normal little girl. Here's her trying to look pouty. Then they take a shot glass or a baby food jar, and they suction it onto their lips, and they leave it there for 20 minutes or so. And then this is what her lips look like afterwards. Now, people are splitting, ruining, busting. We're not going to show you any of the bad pictures. There are amazing pictures of what people are doing to their faces, trying to get pouty lips. And I'm not even sure. I mean, I got a pouty lip. I'm just, you know, if I'm mad, you know, it sticks out a little bit. I don't need it to be any more pouty. You can tell when I'm not happy. Man, my lips are telling you about it. But that's the whole deal. Then the last one is another one from the Jenner family. I think Kim Kardashian. I'm not an expert on these people, but this is called a blood mask. And what happens is they prick her face all over and allow blood to form on her face, and that is some sort of treatment, sort of like a mud bath or cucumbers or, you know, all the things we used to do to. I never did it, but anyway, you probably tell by looking, but anyway, moving right along. Things they do to their faces, and now this is a big deal, and this is going all around, and people are trying to do it on their own, and, you know, weird stuff going on. The team in graphics said that I needed to do something to my face, so they did some Snapchat things with my face. Terrible. Just terrible. Think we have some more? Yes. Yes, just terrible. Okay, that's enough of that garbage. What are those? Why are we having intern pictures up there? Oh, thank you. That's interesting. Anyway, yeah, get rid of that now. I just wondered why we had interns. I didn't ask for my mug to go back up there again. Here's the truth. The best thing you can do for your face is smile. It's the best thing anybody can do for their face is to smile. And in fact, the Bible says in Psalms 34:5, New King James says it this way. They looked to him and their faces were radiant. And their faces were not ashamed. You know, you can do this test in the bathroom. Most people in your bathroom have lights above the mirror. Go in there where the lights are shining on your face and just go in with a normal look and look at your face in the mirror and then smile. What happens is it causes reflection of light off your face when you smile that isn't there when you don't smile. And you can test it. It'll work that way. That's what the Bible's talking about. It says their faces were radiant. In fact, the Message translation translates it this way. Look at him. Give him your warmest smile. Never hide your feelings from him. A lot of times what we're feeling shows on our face unless we're fighting what we're feeling and trying to keep it from showing on our face. And so your face is really kind of a temperature gauge for what's going on. Your face can be a sign that you're encouraged, blessed, at peace, a lot of different things. But your face can also be a sign that you're discouraged. And here's the problem. Doubt very often leads to discouragement. When you begin to have a lot of doubts, you can end up in a place where you're very discouraged, where discouragement tries to get in and get a hold of your life. What's it mean to be discouraged? Some of the definition is the act or instance of discouraging, the state of being discouraged, something that discourages. What happens when you run into a difficult situation? Discouragement. Here's a few quotes for you. The first one from M.H. Alderson. If at first you don't succeed, you're running about average. Did you hear that? No, moving right along. This is W.C. Fields. If at first you don't succeed, try again, then give up. There's no use in being a darn fool about it. Okay, this one's by Anonymous, and I have noticed a lot of quotes by Anonymous in my life, but anyway, if at first you do succeed, try to hide your astonishment. You know, when Carol and I lived in Denver, one of the things that we did, Carolyn's dad had a cleaning service, a janitorial service, Columbine Janitorial, and he was very successful at it. Had a whole group of banks, Key Savings, had medical buildings, had the Inglewood Police Department, lots of accounts, and we cleaned for him. Carolyn cleaned for him from a little girl, and it was just something we learned how to do. We had a background in it, knew how to do it, knew how the business was run. So at a point after her dad had passed away, we thought, well, maybe we'll start a janitorial business. And so I called it Agape Janitorial, which is it's an A, so it's in the phone book pretty fast. Was also the word for love, you know, from the Greek for love from the New Testament. And I went around, passed out cards, knew what I was talking about, did all sorts of things that way. And the truth of the matter is, I did not get one account. And it was kind of discouraging. And it kind of, you know, you get doubts. You know, you try to smile and you try to go forward. Then you find out or hear about another business that's doing really well. And you're like, well, will it ever happen for me? Or will anything good come of this? And I asked, and in my case, actually, no. It never went anywhere. We never got the business going. It was a flop. Anybody ever have a flop before? I had a flop. And when I shared this at Creative Team, one of the people at Creative Team says, man, that's great to know. And I said, why? He said, well, because you look pretty successful now. And I said, well, everybody's flopped. Everybody faces failure. Everybody has things that don't go as you'd like them to go. And you've all asked the same question about your own lives, things that you've dealt with. The truth is, discouragement is an occupational hazard of doing life. You're going to have to learn to deal with discouragement and doubt if you're going to do life. Because it just comes against your heart and your mind. And it's another thing that's very difficult is when people desert you or people leave you or people give up on you. And it's hard not to feel like, man, is that my fault? Did I do something wrong? Jesus himself had that happen to him. It says in John 6:66 and 67, At this point, many of his disciples turned away and deserted him. Then Jesus turned to the 12 and asked, "Are you also going to leave?" I wonder what that felt like for Jesus. I wonder if there was any angst in his words. I wonder if discouragement was knocking at the door of his heart. Did he retreat and go to a quiet place? He did that a lot. He would go and pray. Most of us go and feel like throwing up. Or we turn on country western music, sit in the dark. I wonder if he struggled to maintain a kingdom perspective. Probably not, but I do sometimes. I don't get morose when I feel discouraged. I get mad. I'm not a my personality isn't a quitter or a give up person. I'm a fighter. And I'm not bragging about that right now. I'm not proud of it because most of the time when I'm mad, it's not holy indignation. It's more like a hissy fit. Like I'm just, and you know, the anger of man does not work the righteousness of God. Some people just end up being more depressed by circumstances than others. And I guess it's okay to sit on the pity potty for a while. Just be careful you don't get ring around the hiney. Did I say that in church? I think I did. Unless you're a pastor, you probably don't know this, that when you start a series on doubt, doubt attacks. When you start a series on financial blessing, financial attack starts. When you do a series on marriage, usually your relationship gets attacked. See, wherever you go and you press in, doubt tries to press back. Works in my life. It works the same way for believers when Christians see a truth in the Bible and they start to lean into it. Many times the enemy doesn't want you to gain that ground, and so he'll push back with some doubts in that area to try to paralyze you or stop you. And some people are stopped and don't believe in the truth of Scripture. Why? Because, well, I tried that and it didn't work. No. When you press into something, very often the enemy does. He wants to stop you, and so he presses in to try to stop you. So what do you do when life has you down and results or relationships are bad and you're doubting life and maybe you want to quit, you have some discouragement? Let me give you a few things that will help you in your life. Number one, own up to your doubt and discouragement. Own up to it. Don't hide it. Don't pretend or fake it with God. When it hurts, it hurts. And God is the God who wants to hear about it. Sometimes it just takes a little time to process what you're going through. David in the Psalms, some of the greatest Psalms that were written were David pouring out his heart in complaint about what was going on in his life. Psalms 22 is a great example of that. If you read in Psalms 22, it says, my God, why hast thou abandoned me? Why are you so far away when I groan for help? Every day I call to you, my God, but you do not answer. Every night you hear my voice, but I find no relief. It goes on and on like that. I paraphrase some of it. This is what he said, Dan's paraphrase. God, life stinks right now. There are people I don't like doing things that really tick me off. I can't see you anywhere in this, and to be honest, it's discouraging. Evil people are doing good and good people are struggling. We're getting a raw deal. It would really make my day if you could take a few minutes out of your busy schedule and wipe them off the face of the earth. That's what David would do. Something just like that. You know, you read Psalms 22 through and you know what you end up finding out? That it's actually a messianic psalm. And it perfectly fits Jesus on the cross. And if David wouldn't have cried out to God in those moments, expressing his own pain and sorrow with God putting a prophetic slant on it, we wouldn't have this incredible psalm foretelling exactly what happened to Jesus on the cross. One more prophetic proof that Jesus is the Messiah. So I know we've all felt, you know, like things like that before. When you're doing the best you can and you get the news of a layoff or a sickness or your car breaks down or a financial thing or husband problem, wife problem, your daughter's pregnant, your son is arrested, or whatever it is, you know what you need to do? Cry out to God like David did. Cry out to God. Fortunately, David never stops on the pity party. David never stops there, or else we would only know of David as a victim instead of a man after God's own heart. He cried out to God. He learned to pour out his heart, and then he would get a clearer perspective of what was really going on. Now, I will say this. Primarily, we're called to pour out our heart to God. Now, Facebook is Facebook, and there are some really good things about Facebook and staying in contact with people and doing some things, but if you are in the habit of pouring out your heart on Facebook, that is a cheap emotional release that does not provide any real solution. And you know, well, I just told a few friends and had them pray with me. Well, you know, 30 is a big number. You know, and it used to all be in person. See, we didn't do this on Facebook back in the day. We, you know, you'd see somebody coming and you'd say, hey, man, would you pray with me? And you'd pray with you, and, you know, you'd share it with friends. You know, those people who ran from you when they saw you coming? Yeah, and we would share it, and you get an emotional release by sharing your problem, and then somebody prays for you or pats you on the back, but that doesn't solve anything in the long run. What solves it is crying out to God. Because God is the one who can really answer what you're doing. Now, certainly you can trust in a few, you know, confide in a few trusted advisors. There's nothing wrong with getting people to pray with you. But don't let that replace you personally crying out to God. 1 Samuel 30, verse 3. This is the story of David coming back from fighting with his men, and he comes back to his hometown called Ziklag. When he gets back to Ziklag, this is what he finds. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire. And their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. This is an incredibly difficult situation, super discouraging situation that he's in. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him. His own army, his own men, said, I think we're going to stone you. Should we stone David? Should we kill him? Because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. And you know what? He didn't even have 30 Facebook friends to tell his problem to. At this point, he had no one. Everybody else was talking about killing him. And so what did he do? He cried out to God. The rest of the story is that they went and got their wives back. They got their children back. And then they caught the guys that did it, who had raided 7 other cities and got all the money they stole from theirs and the people from them as well. God had a greater blessing for him in it. This is what godly people do when life has drained every drop of courage out of you, a vision out of you. When you're hurting, you cry out to the living God. Getting honest and pouring out your heart, a very powerful thing. What else? Number two, realize there are spiritual forces at work. Realize there are spiritual forces at work. Have you ever walked into a room and sensed there was more going on there than meets the eye? Felt it. You know, Carol and I were driving one time. We didn't know anything about this at the time, but we were driving up towards Manitou Springs, I believe it was. Anyway, we went through this, started coming to the city limits of this little city, and I went like, whoa, man, this feels weird. What is going on here? This feels really, really strange. And we talked about it for a minute, really didn't know, and went on through the town. And then I researched it later, and it was a town that really had been dedicated to the occult, this little town in the Colorado Mountains. And you know what? We felt it when we came into the city limits. Why? There was more there than meets the eye. Remember when Elisha, the prophet, he was tipping off the Israelite king to what the enemy's king and armies were doing. And so what he would do is when they began to do something, the enemy, to go kill the Israelites, Elisha would tell the Israelite king, hey, this is what they're going to do. This is where they're going to be at. And Israel would get the victory with a much smaller army against a much greater force. And the reason they did is they had intel of all the things he was going to do. And Elijah was getting that from God in his heart. So this army decided, well, it's not working attacking Israel. Let's go find Elisha and kill him. And so Elisha was in the small town, and they went to this small town, completely surrounded it with their entire army. And when they got up in the morning, excuse me, they were completely surrounded, and Elisha's servant looked out there and went, Elijah, we're toast. We're going to die. And this is what Elijah said, 2 Kings 6:16. Don't be afraid, Elisha told him, for there are more on our side than on theirs. Then Elisha prayed, O Lord, open his eyes and let him see. And the Lord opened the young man's eyes, and when he looked up, he saw the hillside around Elisha was filled with horses and chariots of fire. Man, there's more than one realm. So, here's the problem, though. Not all spirits in the room are for you. Ephesians 6, 10 through 12 says this, a final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you'll be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places. The devil has a custom-made strategy for you, and doubt and discouragement is a huge part of it. The good news is God has a custom-made strategy for you, and faith and trust is a huge part of it. Come on. Sometimes discouragement, the discouragement you feel and the doubts you feel are way out of proportion to the actual circumstances. And when that's the case, it's very likely it's a spiritual attack more than just a natural attack. And if that's the case, spiritual forces at our work. So what do? Man, don't put on your track shoes and run towards the problem. You know, oh, this is just the tip of the iceberg. Probably not. It's probably just a blip on the screen. Oh, we're not going to make it. Well, you've made it so far. Don't you think you might make it this time? If God be for us, who can be against us? So what else do we need to do? Remind yourself of the truth. Here's a refrigerator verse for you. Unless, of course, you have a stainless steel refrigerator, which nothing sticks to the front of them. And so we have lost our family's messaging service, and also our only non-digital photo album is gone. Wish somebody would have told me before I bought it, okay? Magnets don't stick to this stuff. Awesome. So we've got the side of it completely covered up. Here's a refrigerator verse if you don't have a stainless steel refrigerator. Philippians 4:8, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. If you're ever going to accomplish anything of kingdom worth, you're going to have to deal with some potentially discouraging things happening to you. And the enemy wants you to stay on the pity potty until you fall in and flush your future down the drain. I've got toilet issues today, I think. You got to meditate on the truth. So I've had people say, I don't know how to meditate on truth. You know how to worry, don't you? All you do is change the subject. You're thinking about it, oh my God, we're going to die, we're going to die. No, just turn around, we're going to live. Get a verse and just keep rolling it over in your heart and your mind. You got to stop and go back. I mean, whenever anything comes to my mind that is not in line with the Word of God, I start out by saying, is it true? Now, when I say true, I don't mean true in the natural. I mean true according to Scripture. Is it lovely? Is it good report? Is it praiseworthy? I will think on those things and just keep saying that over and over. So what is true? God has your back. Come on, God has your back. Romans 8:31. What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can be against us? Verse 32 says, since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? That's what God says. See, some people live their life thinking God's mad at them. You know, I heard a story about a guy going camping, and on his way to the cabin, his car broke down. And he unloads his car, gets it all on his back, and he hikes the last 3 miles, and on the way it starts to rain. Just as he gets the cabin in sight, a bolt of lightning hits the cabin, burns it to the ground. In his discouragement, he leans his head against a tree and says, why me, God? And God responds, the sky's clear, and says, some people just tick me off. It's not true. God's not mad at you. God's not mad at me. God's not even mad at that guy because that's not real. See, confidence, faith, courage comes from knowing God is not only not against you, he's for you. Anybody here ever play tug of war? Maybe for some of us a long, long time ago. Here's the good news. God is on the rope with you. He's pulling with you. Number 5, what else? God has a plan. One of the hardest things for us as a church was when we realized we needed more room, and we were trying to find a way to have more room for God's treasure, which is people, more ways to reach the community and love the people around us. We did a feasibility study on building a building that was 50% bigger than what we had here. We have about 55,000 square feet was what we were going to try to build. Or what we might have, that's 25. Yeah, we have 55, so we're going to build 75. And to do that, it was $27 million. Yeah, that's what we said. I mean, exactly. Like, whoo! And we just didn't hear God saying, you know, mortgage the future of your life and the future of the church on a debt that huge. And so we were like, it was hard. So we all locked ourselves in a room and started listening to country western music in the dark. No, what it did was force us to look for another way. And what we found was God had a plan that manifested in the Avenue, and then in Vieira, and then in Coco, and then God only knows where. See, God has a plan, and even though it looks like you're at a dead end, that dead end is not really a dead end. God has a plan for you. God has your future. That's number 6. Romans 8:18 says, yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory that will be revealed to us later. Sometimes life doesn't come in a neat little package. Answers don't always appear at the moment we need them. I shared this last week, but it's just such a part of where we're at. Told the story of a preacher that was going to take a church, and right before he got hit by a car, and multiple surgeries were going to be necessary, and he was in the hospital all broken up, and the bishop went to him and you know, was concerned that he would be, why me, and angry at God, and when he said to him, you know, if he thought the Lord had been unfair to him, the guy said, of course not. He has all eternity to make it up to me. See, what happens is, very often discouragement forgets final destination. Discouragement forgets final destination. You know, if we only had heaven to live for, it would be more than enough. Take the best that's ever happened to you in this life. Watching your bride walk down the aisle, watching your sons receive their bride, watching your daughter as you walk her down the aisle, seeing your children born, seeing your grandchildren, whatever you can come up with as the best of the best in your life, that doesn't make the top 10 in heaven. How do I know that? Because this is what it says, 1 Corinthians 2:9. That is what the scripture means when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. That's what God has for you, something better than anything we've ever experienced before in his life. You know, when that becomes a reality, we'll be able to say this with Paul, 2 Corinthians 4:1. We're going to have a song. Come on up. People who are going to sing in the band, 2 Corinthians 4:1. That's your cue. Come on. Yeah. Therefore, since God in his mercy has given us this new way, we never give up. We are perplexed, verse 8, on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. I don't know about you guys, but that's what I want to be like when I grow up. More like that. We're going to listen to this song as the band shares it with us.
Take these oceans.